Good evening, everybody. Let's go to the red hymn book tonight. The red hymn book, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart, page 619. 619.
What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I had sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Our next song will be This World Is Not My Home, page 361. 361. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me. If heaven's not my home.
love shines in. Even those. Jesus comes with power to let him win. Love shines in every life that woke inside him. When love shines in, love will teach us how to pray. Love will drive the gloom away, turn our darkness into day. When love shines in, when love shines in, when love shines in, how the heart is turned to singing. When love shines in, when love shines in, when love shines in, joy and peace to others bringing. When love shines in, we may have a fading splendor when love shines in, and a friendship true and tender when love shines in. When our victory shall be won, and our life in heaven begun, there will be no need of sun, for love shines in. Joy and peace to others bringing when love shines in. With that said, any praises so far this week?
I have a praise from 2.5 weeks ago. I quit smoking and I haven't looked back.
All right. Maureen has quit smoking and it's been 2.5 weeks, so that's great. Lawrence. All right, what's his name?
Ty.
Ty?
Ty. With a K.
Kai. Ah. So, Lawrence, it's your sister.
That's his nephew.
So, it's your nephew. You have a new nephew in the family named Ty. Congrats. All right, any other praises? Louise.
Sherry got her meds yesterday.
All right, Sherry's got her meds yesterday. And we miss you, by the way. Norma.
I got my meds yesterday too, now I can sleep.
Norma's got her meds today, and now she can sleep. Sleep is good.
I love it.
All right. I enjoy sleeping too. Any others? Barbara.
I don't have a praise, but I have to go see my grandmother who passed away
So the 11, 9/11 is on Saturday, 12, 13th. Yep. Shima Takahara.
Oh.
So on Monday, Barbara goes to see Dr. Shima Takahara, who's a really good doctor in our town, and is going to get her ears checked. Can you hear me now? Yeah. Is there any others? Matthew.
I'd like to pray. My daughter's going to New York this Sunday, this weekend. So,
all right.
9/11.
You said this Saturday?
Huh?
When's she going?
She's going this weekend.
This weekend?
I think she said Saturday or Sunday she's going to be.
And what's your daughter's name again?
Lauren.
Lauren. So Lauren, Matthew's daughter.
And the family.
And the family.
Granddaughter.
And your granddaughter, yep, are traveling to New York this weekend. So we play. Pray for their safety.
Yeah.
Lois.
Yeah, I've got an appointment Friday in Roseburg, and they're going to check my ankle again and try to find out why I'm having all the pain.
All right, Lois is going to go to Roseburg on Friday to see the doctor to see why she continually has pain in her ankle. Tom.
Erica and I and Kyle are going to Portland this weekend for the mini car race.
Well, that'll be fun.
Hopefully, yeah.
Tom and Kyle and Erica are going to Portland for the IndyCar race this weekend, so we'll pray for your safety.
And Comic-Con's on Friday.
And Comic-Con's on Friday. Comic-Con is like a comic book festival. Yeah. That's when Tom is like in a candy store. Lawrence. Yep.
About a week ago, and please pray for healing.
Dr. Bennett?
Yes.
Yep. Lawrence saw Dr. Bennett and is recovering from his ingrown toenail. He's a good doctor as well. Got to be a little biased there. He's a great guy. All right, Pam.
I have two. Please pray for Mom. She's going through a rough patch right now. And also, we're going to Eugene tomorrow for both of us have appointments with different doctors tomorrow.
All right, we need to pray for Bessie. She's kind of having a rough time right now. And Pam and Franklin are traveling to Eugene to see both their doctors. We need to pray for their safety and that their appointment goes well. All right. You guys want to give an update on Wilma? This is an update on Wilma. And everybody can hear you, Dave.
Okay. Well, basically, I guess Wilma had collapsed earlier when they were at Dishner's, had to go to the hospital. They did some testing. They initially were saying pneumonia. Now I guess she's also got gallstones, which brought on the passing out part. So now they're going to have to remove the gallstones. Need a lot of prayers for healing for her. Need to pray for comfort for Gordon. Definitely pray for strength for my wife, driving them all around too. I know I pray every day for that.
Yeah. Is she home now with that?
Okay. They took her home after the hospital decided what was going on. She's at the home.
Actually, they took her home before the hospital.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, because it wasn't until the doctor looked at the x-rays that they saw the gallstones.
They saw the gallstones in the x-rays.
Yeah.
Okay, so Wilma's got pneumonia that we need to pray for, that she recovers from that. She also potentially has gallstones. So we need to pray for Wilma. We need to pray for Gordon during this time and for Prudence, and pray for David as well. Pray for the family.
Yeah, I'll tell you. Prudence is really kept me from falling apart today.
Yeah. You know, I'm just thankful for our family and our church. We are always there for one another.
Thank you.
And you know, some churches aren't like that. You know that? And I'm just blessed that we are each here for each other. And when somebody goes down, we're there. And that's just a blessing from God. We may be a small congregation, but we're a great congregation.
Yeah, big hearts.
All right, let's look at here. Any other additions? Oh, Randy Kellogg. So Randy's mother is the one that had just passed away a few weeks ago. Now Randy is not doing good, and he's in OHSU. So we need to pray for Randy at this time. Pray for his daughter Kendall as well, and be with that family. Norma.
Yes, I talked to Judy today, and she said that when he was in the hospital here and they put him on a respirator, they punctured a hole in his lung, and that's why he's up at OHSU.
So Judy had said that he had punctured...
Yeah, they punctured his lung when they were giving him respiration and whatever.
So when Randy was getting respiratory help, they accidentally punctured his lung.
So we need to pray for him. Like you said, his daughter, I don't know how big a family they have, but we need to pray for them this time. You know, I was just thinking about it when I was up here. There's a gentleman that comes here, and he's always a little bit late, but he's always here, dedicated every Wednesday evening. He hasn't been here the last couple of Wednesdays. What's his name?
Bobby Rook.
Bobby Rook. So.
Oh, well, it's the middle of haying season.
Huh?
It's the middle of haying season right now.
Oh, okay. All right, that's why we haven't seen him in a while.
Yeah.
Okay. I was just a little concerned. All right. Any others? Okay, let's see here. Since you and Eric are going to be on, you still going to start Sunday school this Sunday morning?
Yes.
Okay. Got a blessing. Sunday school comes back for the kids this Sunday, so that's great. So, and my son's birthday tomorrow.
Started school today.
Yep, and he started school today and enjoyed it.
Do you want to sing happy birthday to him?
Oh, we sang to him last time he was here, so.
But, oh, yeah.
All right. Gordon, do you still like to start tonight? Okay. You got it. David?
Dear Father in heaven, we come to you in prayer this time as many need to, dear Lord. So many health issues. It's a tough struggle. We all need your help, so we pray that you'll heal those that are in need that can't receive the healing, and those that just know the plan for you. Pray that you just comfort them and use them. Be with the families of all of us that are suffering right now, dear Lord. The families need strength to help carry through as well. So we pray for many people and pray that you'll continue to guide us, guide this church, dear Lord, this wonderful church. Such great strength there. Prayer for you. We're always so thankful. Pray that you'll help our light to shine outside of this church.
Amen.
Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for today. Thank you for all that you do for us. Helping us through the difficult times as well as the easier times. We thank you that you're just always present in our lives. And thank you for your word that's a continual guidance. And that we can come before your throne room anytime that we want to. And thank you for all those privileges, Lord. And we just ask that you be with those that have been mentioned tonight. Pray especially for Wilma and her situation, and just the upcoming surgeries she's going to have, and just helping to get over this pneumonia. Just pray that you just watch over her and the family and help them. We ask, Lord, that you be with those traveling with Eric and Tom this week and Pam. Franklin, as they're going to Eugene, just pray that they have safe travel mercies. And we ask that you be with Bessie and help her through this difficult week that she's having. And pray you be with Lawrence and give him healing and strength. And pray that you be with Matthew's daughter, her traveling as well. Just pray, Lord, that you just watch over all the needs that have been mentioned by the Jesus' name.
Thank you.
you for being our healer and our refuge. Come to you for all you have to do, Lord. Especially pray for Randy Keller, for her and his family. And I pray for Lola, heal her, Lord, strengthen her, and I pray for Gordon. I'm so excited and I pray for prudence, different strength, and wisdom for everything. And I pray for Bessie and Barbara and Lawrence and Matthew's daughter and Sherry, Lord, please heal her and help her body to recover and for her to be able to come back to church. And I pray for our whole church family and everyone who would like to come back in for different reasons. Please, Lord, give your family their solitude and help them to get closer and closer to Jesus.
Lord, thank you. Opportunity for us to be together and be there for each other. And as Andrew said, this is church with people all the time. And we're there for each other. And there's so much of that. Beautiful rules that we mentioned, and also want to add Andrew, who's working very hard. And saying, as we have to do, and as challenges at work himself. And Janet as well, and the arthritis in the wrist is pain in the wrist. We need help to improve the doctors to help her with these things in Jesus' name.
Pray, Lord, you'll be with Wilma. Pray that you will heal her, Lord. Ease her aches and pains. We also pray, Lord, that you'll be with Gordon and you'll give him strength, Lord. Help him to be strong. Give him strength and let him be able to rest, dear Lord. Pray that you'll be with everybody on the list, everybody traveling. Be with Betsy when she's having a hard time right now, dear Lord, and give her strength. Help her to get through this, dear Lord. Help our nation. Help our church. Thank you for you and your son, dear Lord. We love you and we pray all this. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Dear God, we thank you. We love you, and we thank you for this day. It's been a kind of a crazy day for a lot of us today, and but with your love and your power that you bestow on us, we're thankful and grateful for that. We're thankful that we can come to you at any time in our life, during our happiness and during our sorrows. We pray for a lot of our members that are going to be traveling this weekend to keep them safe, but pray that they have a great time too and enjoy themselves. We thank you for all the praises. We thank you for Sherry and Norma as they got their prescriptions in. We pray for Sherry and Steve and the family. We miss them and hope they come home soon. And be with those that have doctor's appointments this week. Be with Pam and Franklin as they're traveling to their appointment tomorrow. Be with Lois as she's traveling to Roseburg on Friday. And be with Barbara on Monday when she sees Dr. Shima Takahara for her hearing. Bless the doctors that they can heal our church members here and our our families and friends. We're thankful that we're excited and that we have kids back in the church for Sunday school. Bless Johanna and Erica as they continue their ministry with these children, that they learn more about you, that down the road they become Christians, and that they'll be able to teach others that are lost as well and bring them to you. This is a crazy world that we live in. And during this time, we will always honor you and praise you every day. And forgive us when we fail you as well, that we get back on our feet and continue to put you first in our lives. Be with my family and be with our church family as well every day. May we grow and continue to grow in you. And we pray for Derek as he comes to teach to us and continue about the fruit of the Spirit. And that'll be a blessing upon us that we don't just learn it from here, but we share it with others that need it as well. Again, be with Wilma and be with family. David and Prudence is a help as well. She's a huge saint in our church. And truly love her and love our family here as well. Again, just continue to be with this service this evening. And we love you. Amen.
Up our study on the fruit of the Spirit, I guarantee it. Only got one left. So.
We've been four witnesses on the last one, so I wouldn't guarantee anything.
Yeah. I'll guarantee it.
Don't call on the door.
Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. We thank you for the fruit that your Spirit gives to us when we become Christians and helps us to develop those fruit. I pray that you will just help us to learn a little bit more than we knew yesterday, and just give us your insight. Encourage us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're at the last of the fruit, self-control. Thank you. Well, it's in Galatians 5. Yeah. Is where the fruit of the Spirit is. And the Greek word for self-control is self-mastery. In 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 8, Paul is describing different elements that we need in our life. And he writes this, he says, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, to goodness knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. So it's kind of a little, almost the same as the fruit of the Spirit, a couple of them are different. But Peter is explaining, you know, to now that we're Christians and we're experiencing this life in Christ and following Christ, and he's transforming, you know, our nature, that we need to leave behind the old things, the old man, and, you know, learn to develop these fruit that we have in Jesus Christ, these aspects of our Christian character. And we need to learn how to control our attitudes, our actions, and there's so many things that that self-control can play a part in almost every aspect of our lives. You know, everything we do, everything we say, everything that goes through your mind. You know, so self-control can just, it can pretty much be applied to just every area of our life. So if we're really serious about, you know, escaping from the ways of the world, the influence of the world, and really trying to, you know, implement the things that Jesus has taught us, you know, then we're going to try and learn about self-control, how to have self-control in our lives. So like I said, you know, there's a lot of different ways that we could apply this, but I'm just going to pick on one this evening so that we can get finished tonight. But I think one that we all struggle with, even after, you know, becoming Christians, one that's really just kind of seems to stay with you for the rest of your life, is self-controlling your mouth. In James, the third chapter, he talks about this quite a bit. There's a lot of the Proverbs that talk about controlling your mouth. But in James, the third chapter and verse 3, he says, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships for an example. Although they are large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a very small part of your body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of your body. It corrupts the whole body. It sets the course of one's life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human can tame the tongue, because it is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in the likeness of God. Out of the same mouth come both praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. So not having self-control, you know, over our tongues is probably, you know, the easiest way for us to sin. And there's no limits, you know, to the kinds of things that we can say. But we need to learn to learn, you know, there aren't any restraints on your mouth. I wish there were, you know, something that would, you know, you could stop it before it comes out. But a lot of times those things just slip out so fast, and then you regret it after you've said it. But, you know, the Bible describes your mouth and the tongue in different ways. It describes it as wicked, deceitful, perverse, filthy, corrupt, flattering, slanderous, gossiping, blasphemous, foolish, boastful, complaining, cursing, and vile. So that's a pretty long list of things that, you know, could come out of your mouth. And as Christians, you know, we need to make sure that none of those things are coming out of our mouths. And that's going to take a lot of self-control, you know. In Matthew, the 12th chapter, Jesus said that on the day of judgment, we will give an account for every careless word that we speak. For by our words, he said, we will be justified by our words, and by our words we'll be condemned. So, you know, we really have to learn how to have self-control. Now it says, I mean, the word is called self-control, But we know that just like as James was saying here in this passage, no one can do it on their own. No man can tame their tongue by themselves. But with the Holy Spirit, all things are possible. And so, you know, the Holy Spirit is the one that is going to help us to do this. And he can do it, but we have to listen to him. You know, we have to be responsive when he's trying to put that thought in our mind and, you know, as we meditate on God's word and just really trying to develop new skills, new attitudes, new way of thinking. I remember when Isaiah got a glimpse of the Lord's presence, he had this vision of the holy throne room. Remember what he said? Yeah. I'm a man of unclean lips. That was the first thing that came across his mind, you know, that, and he said, we are a people of unclean lips too. Everybody is. So there's something about, you know, I think we feel at different times in our lives, we may not have a vision like Isaiah, but, you know, when you really just had an experience where you just have that intimate moment with God and then you just realize how sinful you are. You know, your sin kind of comes to the surface in those moments. And I think that's what Isaiah was going through when he had that vision of God's holy presence, the holiness of God, and how we're not. And so, you know, and he thought of his mouth, and everything that comes out of his mouth is wicked and evil. And then remember, the angel brought a coal from the fire of God's throne room, and he brought it and he cleansed his lips with that coal. And that's what God can do with us. You know, it's the Holy Spirit is living inside of us. He's doing that. He's purging us from that sinful nature that we once were a part of. And he's cleansing us and he's helping us to speak, you know, words of truth and words that are gonna come out in a positive and good way. One of the examples of Christ, remember, we've been talking about how Christ is a good example of all these things. And we've talked about this before, especially because we went through the book of 1 Peter, but I really like this one in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. Peter reminds us, Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example to follow in his steps, for he committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but he kept entrusting himself to the one who judges righteously. And so I think, you know, when you think of all the times that Jesus had to say the right thing and restrain his mouth to have self-control over what he said, I think this would have been a very tough time. I mean, when you look at the passage of those four incidents in as the Gospels recorded, they were how they were just yelling things at Jesus in that courtroom and saying all kinds of things. They were spitting on him. I mean, just think about that, spitting on Jesus. They were punching him in the face. One Gospel writer said they blindfolded Jesus, started punching him with their fists, and then asking him, who did it? Prophesy who punched you. Now, I mean, I think most of us, we'd get a little bit upset when something like that would happen and want to say something back, you know, anything. And you know, but it says here, during all this, Jesus didn't take any kind of revenge through his mouth when they were doing all of that. That he had restraint on what he said in return. And that would be very difficult, I think, if any of us were in that kind of situation.
There was a movie put out several years ago called The Passion.
Yeah.
And I watched that at my brother's place. Mm-hmm. It wasn't that way. This person cried and he didn't make any noise.
Mm-hmm.
perfect, he died, but it wasn't.
Well, you know, it's, I think any of the Jesus movies, if you watch any of them, I mean, they all have their flaws, you know, because we can't, we try to capture it on film, you know, but of course, it depends on who's directing which movie. And, but I've seen probably all of them, and, you know, they all have their issues, you know, with how they present different things. But, yeah, but, you know, Jesus, yeah, it says here that he just, you know, was able to restrain himself. And so when Peter's using it as an example in this passage in 1 Peter, he's talking about how we have to go through suffering in our life. There's a lot of times where there's injustice. This was injustice. This was God that they were offending here. And if there's any injustice, that was it. And we oftentimes, you know, have to go through that. And we think, well, this isn't, you know, this isn't right. And so we, so then we want to say things, and a lot of times those things come out in an inappropriate way. But just following Christ's example, you know, and trying to hold your tongue. So James says that the Christian who can bridle his tongue is able to bridle his old body. So basically what James is saying is that if you can have self-control over your mouth, then you can have self-control in any area of your life. And so that's where we need to start. You know, just work on your mouth, and then, you know, the rest of your body will follow. And that's an important thing to think about, you know. And I think, like I said, we all struggle with this at various times. In Psalm 39, the writer says, I will guard my ways that I might not sin with my tongue, and I will guard my mouth as with a muzzle while the wicked are in my presence. And I think that's a good one to remember. When the wicked are in your presence, you know, keep that muzzle over your mouth. Yeah, Norma.
Yeah, there's an old saying, I think I've told you before, that never pass up an opportunity to shut up.
Yeah. That's a good one. So James, he uses two analogies here, you know, to show the power of the tongue. First of all, he points out, you know, the bits that are put into the horse's mouth so that they will obey us. And this illustration works really well, you know, because the bit lies on top of the horse's tongue. And then when it's attached to the bridle, you know, and, you know, the person on the horse is able to steer the horse in the direction that he wants him to go, or if he wants him to stop or move forward. And so it directs his whole body. And then the other illustration he gives is of a ship. And, you know, they didn't have ships like they do when Paul was writing this, like they do today. But they had some pretty big ships. If you remember the ship that actually took Paul to Rome, the one that crashed, there was 276 passengers, it said. So had it been pretty big. Rome had some pretty big ships. But they're controlled by a very small rudder, you know, wherever the inclination of the pilot desires. So, and he uses those two examples to say, you know, your tongue is a very small part of your body, yet it can control the whole, you know, direction of your life. And so it's a very important thing, you know, that we gain control over the tongue. And so here's some ways to do that. Resisting temptation to boast. You know, a lot of times be in a place where we could brag, but resisting that temptation. Finding ways to speak grace instead of hurtful things to say. Finding ways to build up somebody instead of tearing them down. Finding ways to encourage or comfort somebody. Words of humility instead of pride. Words of gratitude, you know, just being grateful for things. That's what God wants us to hear from our mouths. You know, and we're thankful and grateful for all the things that he's given us. So just, you know, trying to be in tune with the Spirit. You know, what what Jesus, you know, the WWJD, what would Jesus do? What are you going to say, you know, that if Jesus were in your shoes, how would you say that? So, and then he gives this illustration about, you know, how destructive a fire can be. And we know that the last couple of years in Oregon have been terrible. And just how many of our forests and homes in Oregon have been destroyed, also in California, but all over the world, you know, it's becoming more and more prevalent. But it's a very destructive thing. And, you know, one spark can, and the fire feeds off of itself, you know. As long as it has oxygen and something to burn, it just feeds off of itself, and there's really no end to it. And so this is kind of what happens with your tongue. You know, once you, if you just keep letting it do whatever the devil wants you to do with your tongue, it just gets worse and worse and worse. And we, you know, we've seen people that have very destructive tongues, and it just kind of, it takes over their personality, it takes over, nobody wants to be around them, you know, it's just a very terrible thing. So it can turn into something very destructive if we let it. So we need to make sure that, again, that the Spirit, we have to work with the Spirit, because we can't do this on our own. We have to pray about this. In Proverbs 15:28, the writer says, "The heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked just pours out evil things." So if you have a heart that's righteous, you're going to ponder what you're going to say. Think about what to say before you say it. And then it's not always easy to do, because a lot of times we're just, you know, rattling off things. But take a split second to think about what's going to come out of your mouth.
There was a girl living with friends of ours.
Yeah.
And somebody said to her, "Well, why don't you think about what you're going to say before you say it?" And she said, "Well, how do I know what I'm going to say before I hear myself say it?"
Yeah. Andrew?
Sometimes, you know, on TV, sometimes there's a bleep. Mm-hmm. Too bad we're not like an internal bleep instead.
Yeah, but if we take just a split second, you know, when you know what you're going to say, before it gets from your thoughts to your mouth, and then just say, is this the right thing to say? Yeah.
But also, and it's like sometimes you're in an environment. Sometimes you just got to get yourself out of an environment, like fear around too.
Oh, sure, yeah.
I mean, that's one of the biggest things. Like, mm-hmm. Wherever your environment is, that's sometimes...
Well, and, you know, the Bible encourages fleeing. It's not always being a coward. If you know, well, one time Paul told Timothy, you know, flee youthful lusts. You're in a situation where you need to flee and get out of there, and if you know that your mouth is going to say something it shouldn't, then just leave. Yeah, so that's a good principle too. If you can't control it, get out of there. So, yeah, there's different ways to respond with that, but...
They say that if the walls can play back, mm-hmm. You know, that everything is in the walls and all the words that have been said. That
we'd all be shamed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So one way too is, you know, people use their mouths to gossip, which is a terrible thing. Slander and gossip, which are closely related, but you can tear people's lives apart through that. So that's a terrible thing that comes through your tongue. Also lying. Person that continually lies, can't be trusted. Filthy language, anger, you know, outbursts of anger and rage. All those kinds of things are, you know, types of things that we need to work on, whatever your weakness might be, you know. And then James talks about different beasts, you know, that just about every creature can be tamed, and I know probably most of you, well, I was anyway, fascinated whenever I went to the circus and saw these tigers and lions, you know, that, you know, with the whip, you know, this lion tamer could just keep them all under control. And it was a very fascinating thing to see. And he uses that example that wild beasts can even be controlled. I don't know if they had lion tamers back then, but we do now. But just that, you know, every beast can be tamed to a certain extent, but the tongue, you know. So again, but without the Holy Spirit, it can't be done. And that's why, you know, it's so people in the world that don't have control. But even when we have the Spirit, it's difficult. If we're, like I said, if we're not listening to the Spirit, if we're not staying in tune, you know, with how he wants us to respond to that. So, and what we want to use our tongues for is not only just lifting people up, like I mentioned before, but also praising the Lord, you know, worshiping and praising God's name. And then at the end of the passage there, James says, you know, how can we praise God and then go slander somebody, you know, after we're done praising the Lord? You can't mix the two. So, you know, we need to make sure that what's coming out of our mouth is always edifying and uplifting, and that we're not doing one thing when we're at church and doing something else, you know, when we're not at church. So just putting a guard over our mouths and asking the Spirit to just help us. So, and it takes time. It takes a lot of patience. But so what are some of the things that we can do? The more, you know, what I talked about Sunday night, which I won't go into all that again, but just washing our minds with the Word of God and just spending time in God's Word, you know, is going to, well, the Spirit through that is going to tell us where we've been not, where we've been missing the mark, and where we've been failing, and he's going to help us to, you know, remind us of the things that we need to be doing to have self-control.
Also, people you hang around with, they talk mm-hmm. bad, you end up talking bad.
Yeah.
And when you leave them, you're still talking bad.
Yeah, right. So if you make sure you're spending time with people that are edifying and are going to, you know, bring you closer to the Lord, that's a better thing than being around characters that are going to pull you away from the Lord. Also, prayer. You know, we need a lot of prayer. Just praying to God about this. If you know, if self-control is something that you really struggle with, just make sure it's in your prayer every day. You know, lifting that up, asking God to help you with it. Because, you know, again, it's something that we all at different times struggle with, at least in certain areas of self-control, like I said, with our mouths. But there's so many areas of self-control that we need. We need self-control over our time. You know, the world that we live in is just so busy, 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 and just having self-control over your time is a big one that we need to have as believers. Making sure God has, you know, a significant portion. Well, really, all of our day belongs to the Lord, but you know, studying his word, being with him in prayer, and doing the things that he wants us to do. So another one that you might not think of is fasting. You know, fasting is a really good way to learn self-control. If you really struggle with self-control and want to get a handle on it, I would suggest fasting. I did some fasting, especially in college, quite a bit. I was studying and learning about it, and I experimented with it. And it's a really good way to get a grip on self-control, because when you're fasting, you're controlling your body not to eat. Which is, it's something your body has to have. I mean, you have to have food to survive, right? And so, if you can learn how to fast and train your body to do without food, you can tell your body to not do a lot of things. So it's a great way just to kind of have that self-mastery, just to learn how to say no to things, you know? Because that's basically the bottom line of self-control. It's not being able to resist something and not being able to say no and push it out of your life. But fasting helps you to just train your body not to eat. I mean, that's just one of the just basic things about it. I mean, when you fast, you're trying to experience this deeper relationship with the Lord. Maybe someday I'll do a study on fasting and we can talk about it. But there's some really great things that come out of fasting. But one of the greatest thing is just a deeper, intimate way to seek your Creator. Sort of in the way that, you know, when you pray, how you're able to connect with God. And when you really develop your prayer life, you know how powerful that can be. Well, it's the same thing with fasting. You know, if you've done a little bit of fasting, you start to experience some of that. But then if you fast more and more and fast longer, it's like, you know, just like a deep, rich prayer life where you just have this inner connection with the Lord. And it's just a really great way to, another avenue to connect with your Creator. But it also helps you to say no to things, and it's a really great thing to do. But you know, the Holy Spirit, again, we have to listen to Him, you know, when He is speaking words into our minds, when He's speaking to us through the Word of God, or God speaks to us through prayer too, you know, and when He's speaking to you, to listen. You know, to really listen. Remember when Elijah, he was trying to figure out all these things, and then God just says, listen to my still small voice. Just getting everything quiet. You know, you can't really listen to God when there's noise everywhere. But just really having everything quiet and being able to just listen to what God's trying to say, you know, that can be very, very powerful. I'll leave you with one more scripture verse. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24, Paul compares the Christian life to an athlete, how he has to go into strict training. If you're going to be an athlete, you have to go into strict training, and you have to beat your body and make it your slave. So he says, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. We do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body. I make it my slave so that after I preach to others, I will not be disqualified from the prize. So this is a great analogy, because if you've ever done any kind of sports or athletic things, if you're a runner or if you just any kind of sport that you're training for, you have to have some strict discipline, you know, to get to that goal that you're trying to achieve, whatever it is. You're trying to run a marathon, or if you're trying to be the best basketball player, or whatever your goal. You know, it's going to take some strict training. You have to discipline your body and make it your slave, like Paul's saying here. And if you really want to win, if you want to do a poor job, you don't have to do that well. But if you really want to do your best, you know, it's going to take some discipline. And as Paul said another time, you know, discipline isn't easy at first. It's difficult. But afterwards, there's a reward for discipline. And so discipline, it's going to take time, it's going to be painful. You know, the old saying, no pain, no gain, that kind of thing. It's going to be painful sometimes, and it's hard, it's difficult to be really disciplined in something. But it's going to pay off. And so your Christian life is very much like that, you know, where you're going into the strict training, especially with self-control. You know, there's disciplines that you need to implement to make those things happen, and it's going to involve just a real desire to accomplish that goal. And then one of the other things that goes along with it is just surrender. You know, giving up something you desire, and that can be hard sometimes. And again, the greatest illustration of that is Jesus in the garden. You know, just giving up. He had to give up, you know, the easy road, and just, he didn't want to go down that difficult path, but just surrendering it to God and saying, okay, God, you know, your will be done, not, not my will be done. And that's kind of the bottom line for self-control too. Just, you know, giving up your control and just letting the Spirit be the one to have that control in your life, because you can't do it on your own, but the Spirit can enable you to accomplish whatever it is that you need self-control over. And, you know, Jesus was able to surrender that to the Lord and just say, your will be done. And he was able to go to the cross. So a lot of things that we have to do in life aren't easy, and it's going to take some effort. And especially when, you know, sometimes you're frustrated with somebody and you want to say something back. It's a hard one. But the Lord can help us to be edifying and say positive things to people that offend us, and we can learn from the Lord. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for these different fruit that we've been able to just think about and talk about and study from your word, and different ways that we need to work on the fruit of the Spirit. Lord, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would remind us of these truths. Help us to really just study your words so that we know how to develop the fruit. Help us to have a rich prayer life so that you can speak to us, you know, what needs to be done. Just help us to really strive to do our best. Like Paul said with the illustration with the athlete, to just really go into strict training and to just give you everything that we have so that we can really be the kind of Christians that you want us to be, Christians that are pleasing to you, Christians that are going to be a shining light, an example to the rest of the world around us that's watching our every move. Lord, we want to be positive examples. So help us do that. We ask it, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.